Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I extend a very warm welcome to each one of you. My name is Ruben, and on behalf of Team DentistChannel.online, I invite you to a very interesting and a very important live webinar on the topic Clinical Dentistry in COVID-19 Era. I would now like to welcome a speaker for this webinar, Dr. Himanshu Gupta. Dr. Himanshu Gupta is a name synonymous to the Indian dental fraternity. He is a healthcare management professional with 15 years of progressive clinical and administrative experience at the senior level. He is trained by the World Health Organization on preparedness to overcome the COVID-19 pandemic. He is a visionary with strong operational skills and deep understanding of issues pertaining to the healthcare access and delivery, particularly in India. A thoughtful communicator and effective problem solver while working on complex issues in compliance with government laws and regulations. He has a plethora of accolades to his credit, like the Six Sigma Green Belt in healthcare. He has demonstrated leadership skills in managing relationships with senior management and key partners. He is innovative, result-oriented, and specializes in effective utilization of an integrated healthcare delivery system focused on patient-centric care. He is currently the director of oralcare.co.in, an emerging brand in digital dentistry space. A very warm welcome, Dr. Himanshu, and I now request you to kindly move on with the live webinar.
Thank you, Ruben. Thanks a lot for your nice words of introduction. And I welcome all the participants who have prepared themselves to understand how clinical dentistry will be there in COVID-19 era. And I'm thankful for their Sunday morning time. It's obviously a tough phase which is going on in terms of lockdown. And at this point of time, learning will make us more skillful and take us with more confidence when we want to move in clinical dentistry during COVID-19 pandemic. Whatever is coming from me is all because of experience, what we have gained out of handling the COVID-19 positive patients at our hospital. So whatever you'll find is all scientific basis based on the inputs received during training from World Health Organization, and then saving lives and giving some good primary dental care to the people visiting us. So this is going to be the scenario in COVID-19 era. When you want to practice dentistry, you have to have a lot of protections, not for only yourself, your staff and the patient as well. And believe me, dental consultation just for a minor work will cost more than 3,500. Treatment cost will be less and protection cost will be 3 times. This is going to happen. And this will continue for some months or maybe for years. And this is all about what I received as trainings from various platforms, WHO platform and the FICCI-induced NatHealth platform. And believe me, the day we realize that the pandemic is going to be in a bad way, all stakeholders, the important stakeholders at St. Nandlal Dudh Hospital, they all were forced to undergo training to understand what's happening around the world and moreover what's happening in China, Italy, US and various countries. So then we were prepared how to handle and how to take care of these scenarios. And this is what we achieved. We have treated a 7-year-old, we have treated a 59-year-old, and both were went back home successfully with all their charm and pleasure coming back to them. So it's not that we cannot treat patients of COVID-19. It's all process driven and protocol driven. Moreover, timely management of each and every symptom of COVID-19 pandemic makes the whole difference. Now, when coming to the dental aspect, I'm not going into detail of making you aware what is coronavirus and what is COVID-19. By plethora of knowledge circulated in last 2 months through WhatsApp, you all are aware of what it is. For management of patients in dentistry, it is the time to understand how we can take care of the issues which are going to come to us by means of patients' calls or patients' complaints. So we need to see what should be the principles for treatment. Make sure assessment of each patient's COVID-19 status is must, and it has to be recorded using local health system protocol. The district health authorities, the local municipal bodies, they are giving you various protocols to follow, and you must stick to it. And we need to follow a dental triage as well, using 3 A's. One, advice. Second, analgesia. Third, antimicrobials wherever needed. So patients should be advised that treatment options are severely restricted. So your first consultation is not happening as a physical contact. The first consultation is happening on a telephonic call or via media of digital ways. Once you are able to get the primary understanding of what patient is going through, you can advise online, you can advise by prescription, sending them a digital prescription. You can recommend them analgesia as per the need of the hour, or need, if added, to be added, antimicrobials as well. And then the patient should call you back after 2 days or 3 days. And if the symptoms have still not resolved, then is the time you have to take something important as a decision so as to help the patient. Make sure that you have good contacts with the local pharmacies, so that when you are writing a digital prescription, that prescription is well attended. And not only that, they are able to supply the medicines to the patients. Another important thing is those dental conditions that cannot be managed by the patient and require urgent dental care should be referred to the designated urgent dental care center following local protocols. There are a lot of hospitals where dental departments are existing, and a few have been nominated as the centers for urgent dental care. Make sure that you should keep complete records of all the patients, their contacts who are getting them in, including all those who are involved in care management and further referrals. This record makes a lot of sense in this COVID-19 pandemic because of various reasons. Referrals should follow local handover guidelines and templates, because you are sending a patient either to a hospital or to a clinic. At both the places, what are the facilities? Your decision will make a difference in handing over that patient to other facility. So these are all important things which we have to follow. Then comes a very important decision, how you should assess. Now, I have said that first call or first interaction should happen either on telephone or by digital communication. So that gives you a lot of questions. You are able to understand the problem of the patient. Then you need to decide whether the patient needs urgent care, where pharmacological management followed by telephone follow-up is the first line of working with the patient. If not, then how the patient responding, depending on that, convert the patient, assess it as emergency care. Now, when you convert or assess as emergency care, these patients have to be attended immediately to further protect from deterioration. And if you are able to get primary satisfaction or primary support as a good support via your pharmacological management, then you can put it as a scheduled care, which can be done as and when the services are restored. Once you have done the interaction, and if the urgent care has worked well, you need not worry. But if the patient is walking in for emergency care, then you have to do COVID-19 screening. You must master this risk questionnaire, because this gives you a lot of courage to understand the patient is with positive symptoms or asymptomatic, but with a lot of answers in the areas of geographical location, history of exposure, body temperature, or some respiratory symptoms. So that again gives you a very clear understanding that whether the patient is high risk or a low risk. Then comes whether the patient has walked in for emergency dental management. We understand that because we have given primary urgent care. That has not worked. Because of that, patient is now here in our operatory or in our clinic for emergency dental management. Now, when we are attending these patients, make sure we have to follow all the preventive guidelines to protect ourselves, to protect our staff, to protect our infrastructure. All those things have to be properly taken care of. And you need to understand by your evaluation whether the procedure which you are opting is going to produce aerosol. If your answer is yes, look for pain relieving methods without producing aerosol first. You can use a slow speed micromotor or chemomechanical methods to enter the pulp chamber. However, if your answer is no, then just perform the emergency management procedure, whatever way you are looking at. In both the situation, if you feel that you are not able to handle the patient, attend the patient, manage the patient, it's always better refer the patient to nearby emergency medical facility for assessment and management, which could be a nearby hospital where the dental department along with other facilities are existing. These are the common questions. I'm sure you are aware of it. These are the questions which are the COVID-19 screening questions. Do you have symptoms of any of the following? This is your first question to the patient. And then there are subsets: fever, cough, sneezing, sore throat, myalgia, fatigue, difficulty in breathing. History: have you traveled outside the country in past 30 days? If yes, then you need to know which countries are the hot countries where the COVID-19 is already there. Or have anyone from your family, close contact, traveled outside the country in past 30 days? If answer is yes, again, you need to understand from which countries. If not international, then have you traveled inside India to other cities in past 15 days? Again, know the name of the cities to understand whether those cities are affected by COVID-19. Have anyone from your family or close contact traveled inside India to other cities in past 15 days? This is again giving you the similar history of understanding the patient's presence in any of the COVID affected areas. And if exposure to a confirmed COVID-19 case or suspicious patient in the last 2 weeks comes as a history, make sure you have to be very cautious to attend such patients. Even the history of visiting a healthcare facility where the COVID-19 patients have been treated makes sense to understand and safeguard your interest. So these are very, very important questions which one must ask to their patients. Depending on all those questions, you can have a very good understanding which is going to be high risk, which is going to be low risk. So if you see this chart where the geographical location areas, stage 3 outbreak, community transmission, history of exposure, temperature, respiratory symptoms are giving you a sort of risk calculation. All in red is high risk. And all in green is low risk. It is not no risk. So make sure in all the combinations, you have to be alert in attending such patients. Now, we have taken the history, we are knowing what is going to happen to the patient. We are aware that now the patient is in emergency care and we have to offer some procedure. This is the time when you have to wear your protection drives. Use of PPE, including eyewear, masks, gloves, caps, face shields, protective outwear is strongly recommended for all the healthcare givers, no matter it's the operator or the assistant. Both have to have similar level of protection for each other. Triple layer surgical mask can be worn by all healthcare providers when the patient and other people are within 1 to 2 meters. Sometimes we need more than one person to assist. So we have to be careful for all who are present in that area. Particulate respirators, these are the N95 masks authenticated by the National Institute of Occupational Safety and Health, or FFP2 standard mask set by, this is the standard which is set by European Union. These are recommended for routine dental practice. because even in routine also, there are certain procedures which are, when we are using our dental materials, some or the other aerosols are produced. If you get a chance to use FFP3A standard mask, that is one of the best in COVID-19 positive patients. I repeat, for positive patients. And this will be considered as essential step for protection. Just an overview of how a personal protective equipment looks like. You have a coverall, you have the gum, you have the barriers, you have the gum boot covers, which are mandatory as a shoe cover. You have the nitrile gloves, mask, everything what is needed. With this, you also get a bag. This bag is specially needed when you are discarding off your PPE. You cannot put it in your regular biomedical waste. You have to put it separately, label it as biohazardous, and then you have to deliver to the biomedical waste handlers separately. So this is a very cautious step. How to wear it? It's a whole chart. In our country, AIIMS has given a complete flow of how a donning technique starts, how we have to, what is first and what is last. And this is very, very important because we have to see all contamination should be completely taken care of. That's the reason why it's a specific technique. Same way, after completing your procedure, when you are removing your stuff, PPE, then also you have to follow it. And believe it, these zones are separate. Where you are putting your PPE and other structures, and where you are removing your PPE, both these spaces are at different location. So this is important part, because if we do not understand why it is to be removed separately, it will make a big chaos in our own clinic. And I understand a lot of clinics are very small in size. So this is going to be a tough step for those small clinics where donning and doffing is going to take some amount of manipulation in their own space. Mask, yes, we all know when this sort of crises are happening, there are a few fake masks, there are a few genuine masks. If you see 3M masks, there is one level which is there at the base of the right side green mark, which gives you the quality assurance. But as of now, look for reputed dealers or your own suppliers who have given you the material since long. So that is going to be the biggest reliability factor, your vendors, and then how well you receive the N95 mask. And you can use them and reuse them as well. WHO has given a very good procedure of hot air oven, where under 70 degrees centigrade, if you are keeping your N95 mask for 30 minutes, you can reuse them frequently. So this is a good cost saving, which is possible by using this method. Now, why mask and respirator? There are two different things. Masks are loose fitting, the most of the time covering the nose and mouth, and it's for one-way protection. When you are using the mask during surgery, it is basically to prevent coughing, sneezing, or on the vulnerable patients. Whereas if you are using a respirator, it's giving you a lot of safety because it's quite packed. You'll find that around your mouth and nose, it's compactly sitting there. And it's also allowing you to breathe properly. And whatever breathing is happening through some or the other air filter-based mechanism. Certification of these masks is to be verified. NIOSH is one of the best certifying body. And if these are certified, you are assured that the safety levels are very good. But which mask gives you how much protection is also an important part. N95, if we see by American standard or the recommendation by disease control CDC, the most widely used mask is N95. However, in Europe, there are two different standards, FFP2, FFP1, 2, and 3. So these are various standards, but let us focus on the straightforward possibility of what we are able to get in the market. So in Indian market, N95 or FFP2 or FFP3 are easily available. Make sure they have certification and then you can use them. If you are using FFP2 and FFP3 masks, you'll find significant difference in protection for 0.3 microns, all the particles for which are 0.3 microns in diameter or larger. So this is how the mask is selected, and we know in dentistry, we are very, very closely working to the opening of the respiratory tract, that is the mouth and nose, and that's the reason why we have to be highly, highly protected about ourselves first. Now, let us look into the general situations when the patients are walking in. Make sure there are visual alerts for patient awareness. You can use certain posters, or you can display some small video that how they have to walk into the clinic and how they have to sit in the clinic. And if they want to cough, what are the cough etiquettes and how they should follow the hand hygiene practice. You might have to modify your patient waiting area because now the norm of social distancing has to be taken care of. Make sure all who are walking in your premises, right from reception, they should be using an alcohol-based hand rub so that they are not carrying anything as an infection in their hands or contamination in their hands to your premises. Make sure you provide face masks. These can be plain cloth masks just for the safety of their safety as well as the safety of the people who are interacting with the patient. So it works bilaterally. Make sure you have tissue paper dispenser and foot operated waste fin in all your operatories. So if the patients are using any sort of tissue paper or napkin, tissue napkin, then they can discard it by their own hands without touching the wind. Government has recommended hand washing with soap and water to be made available in every space where the patient are getting attended by the doctors. So make sure you have this facility in your operatory, in your clinic. Avoid uses of commercially split or centralized or window air conditioner. We have been left, right and center knowing about the problems which are there with this sort of device. But if you have HEPA filters in your operatory, then probably you need not worry because it's moreover to have regular air exchanges instead of one-sided air and not getting filtered. So that's the reason why the air conditioners have been denied or devoid of use in such situation of pandemic. It is also recommended to use maximum natural and mechanical ventilation by increasing the use of fans and exhaust. When you are walking into your clinic, make sure you do not start brooming directly. Keep your areas open, keep all your windows open, let whatever air exchange is happening that should happen, and then look into wet mopping, not in terms of straight away brooming the area. That will increase the particulate area in the whole premises and then can result in bad situation as well. When we are using the instruments, hand instruments, whatever the set of armamentarium we want to use on the patient, we have to clean and sterilize them after every use on patient. Same equipment should not be utilized on other patient just by washing it or by cold sterilization. It should follow a rigid protocol of washing it, then ultrasonic cleaning, then autoclaving it, then you can use it for another patient. If you are using disposables, please discard them and discard them in the same biohazardous bag. All those heat sensitive semi-critical items which cannot resist the autoclaving, 2% glutaraldehyde for 30 minutes or plasma-based sterilization, cold sterilization is available. Plasma-based cold sterilization is most of the time available in multi-specialty hospitals. However, glutaraldehyde, which is commonly termed as Cydex, is available for cleaning or doing a cold sterilization. High-touch clinical surfaces, they must be covered using a physical barrier. Like we're using thin films. They can be used before and after every patient. And all the surfaces which are high surface, metal surface, which are coming in contact again and again, they should be wiped again and again with 70% alcohol. And whenever you are preparing any solution for any use in patient, please make sure that you discard leftover solution, do not reuse it, just throw away. How to clean the floor in the clinic? As I said, walk into your clinic, make your staff open all the windows so that the air is getting exchanged, and then do not start doing grooming or dusting. Use wet mopping, multi-bucket technique. Three-bucket technique is what the WHO has recommended. Here in one bucket one, there is hot water. In bucket two is detergent. And bucket three is 1% sodium hypochlorite, which is for disinfection. And even when you are doing it, sequence is to be followed. One, hot mopping, hot water mopping, followed by detergent, followed by sodium hypochlorite. So last becomes your sodium hypochlorite mopping. And even the mop heads and cleaning cloths must be decontaminated regularly by laundering at 90 degrees centigrade hot water. So whatever mops are there, the head of those mops should be washed under 90 degrees centigrade hot water, and then you can leave it in sunlight for a harsh sunlight for some time. So that also works good in such scenarios. Do not perform disinfectant fogging and fumigation, because we have to avoid all types of aerosols. Now, understanding with all these backgrounds of how the patient is walking in, what we are doing in the clinic to attend the patient, what type of service we have to render, and then what procedure we are looking into, let us come to a very important area where we need to decide what care we want to offer to the patient. As if you recollect from first few slides, I have said that you've already had an interaction with the patient on telephone or on a digital media. So you are knowing either the patient has been receiving some sort of comfort by the self-help, that is the advice you have given on phone. And if the symptoms are still available, then the patients are walking in. So you are aware of the category of your patients. You are aware that the patients could be either walking in after the primary advice, or they are walking in for some urgent care, or lastly, planned for emergency care. So these are the broad ways how to filter out your patients. Now comes these various situations which we are able to handle using flowchart or understanding that how they will be termed as emergency care, how they will be termed as urgent dental care, and what all things will fall in advice and self-help. Let us take a common example of dental swelling. If it is yes, then the question two is, does swelling restrict swelling, swallowing or extending towards eye or any other important organ or area? So that becomes a concern. Now, if your answer is yes, it is causing discomfort and difficulty in swallowing, straight away, patient will go into emergency care. If the answer is no, then you need to check into the pain relief methods, and you need to introduce some antibiotics, or need to reduce whatever the local cause may be or may not be related to extraction or bleeding. If there is no swelling, and patient is giving history of pain, ask for some trauma to the tooth. Or if the patient has been under dental treatment recently, then there could be a possibility of some sort of secondary pain because of the earlier procedure. Again, you have to demarcate them in two categories, yes or no. If the answer is no, that there is no trauma, there is no history of bleeding and all, then probably general dental practice can help by understanding the minor concerns. And here, this group gets segregated as those who can work on advice and self-help. And those who are with pain, history of some comorbidities like diabetes, hypertension, some surgical approach, they might have to be taken in urgent dental care. Could be a referral dental hospital where all facilities are there, and moreover, the protection or the availability of facility will give them much better care instead of a dental clinic. So this is a broad way how you have to plan your patient and you can very well understand the whole affair of patient history till what you want to offer to the patient. Now I'm going with each and every problem, which is most of the time patients are walking in. This is available data, which you can also look into www.sdcep.org.uk. This is one of the best reference I was able to get it. And you can see there is a lot of color coding. If you see the green box, it's always mentioning about advice and self-help. If you see the yellow box, it's always mentioning about urgent care. And if you see the red box, it is emergency care. So just by understanding on left side what is the problem, you have the options of management, how you can look into that. So this is available. This is online available at sdcep.org.uk. You can download it and you can refresh again and again to understand more. Now, commonest cause, if we see, is acute apical abscess, pain, swelling, fever, loss of appetite if the patient has not taken for long. And now if you look into the management part, you will realize all the three managements are appropriately placed. If you want to give analgesia, you want to give antimicrobials and wait for a day or two, this becomes the part of advice and self-help. But if the patient is not responding, then you are going to step two of urgent care. You are finding some spread, you are finding the aggravation of the situation, then you are going for step two. And if you feel you are not able to attend it in your own center and there are a lot of things which are needed to give the required treatment, you always have an option of understanding the gravity of the situation and then plan for emergency care. This can be at your own place if you are able to handle it, or else follow the referral system. Acute periodontal abscess, perio-endo lesions, again, are common occurring issues in either the patient who have taken treatment or were walking with the problem. They most of the time have pain and tenderness of gingival tissue, increased tooth mobility. I think I should not put more of time in mentioning what is acute periodontal abscess. I'll just level the problem and make you aware of how they can be leveled in advice, urgent care, and emergency care. So in acute periodontal abscess or perioendo lesions, again, recommended optimal analgesia can work, your prescription can work, and you can follow the follow-up after 48 to 72 hours to look into how the patient is getting relief. Main intention about this care staging is to avoid this COVID-19 period. That doesn't mean that your patient has to suffer. Your patient has to be attended, has to be clearly mentioned about what is available as of now, and then what is possible in later phase without decreasing the confidence of the patient. You have to keep assuring the patient that options are available, but if first option is working better, then we should postpone the treatment for some days. That's how the staging is there. And all the treatments are possible. That is your best assurance to the patient. Acute pericoronitis, again, a very commonly occurring problems. And now everybody is locked down inside the houses. A lot of stress, they get aggravated. So follow advice and self-help method. You can recommend antibiotics, analgesics, local applicants, and whatever you feel good for that patient. Now, these patients are also giving you a lot of inputs of their food habits, a lot of inputs of their oral hygiene maintenance. So those all things can be added on as a consideration in treatment when you are looking for advice and self-help. In urgent care, these conditions, if spreading any sort of infection without compromising the airway, then also the patient can go long on some or the other sort of medicines which you feel are right for the patient. And then ultimately the patient can take the treatment as an emergency care later. So this whole description is more about what you should do, what you should avoid, and what you should plan. If you get ulcerative lesions, most of the time these can be taken care by only advice and self-help. Some protection and some sort of advice to the patient will most of the time keep these sort of patients away. Try to do that. You'll find that there's no urgent care or emergency care offered in this particular situations. There could be the situations of irreversible pulpitis, dentin hypersensitivity, dry socket if the patient has been treated in the last 1 month or a few weeks ago. All have been recommended either to give advice or self-help or urgent care. That's maximum. There is no emergency care planned here. We know if the dentin hypersensitivity is there, we can always advise patient to use a desensitizing toothpaste and avoid the stimuli which is aggravating the situation. If our understanding of the problems is clear and our prescription is as per the need of the hour, we can not only assure our patient, we can not only satisfy our patient, we will result in maintaining our patient in our own practice. Basically, it's a connect which is getting developed by the whole mechanism, and you are providing the possible treatment and you are planning the remaining treatment. So this is the strategy which works very good, and we are also following at our hospital successfully. If some important case are coming in terms of with some sort of post-extraction hemorrhage, or maybe hemorrhage because of the underlying medication or some trauma, then you have to look into how you should attend such cases, because hemorrhage will become a concern not only for the patient, even for the practitioner as well. And here we need to see whether we are able to stop that bleeding, we are able to control the hemorrhage or not, else we have to have all three categories as primary help, urgent care, and emergency care if the bleeding fails to stop and it is persistent there. So we might have to involve. Sometimes the patients who are with underlying medical ailments, aspirin, who are taking regularly the anticoagulants and all, then these scenarios are more often present. And you know that the comorbidities are risky in pandemic of COVID-19. So you have to be very, very careful when you are attending the patients who are with these comorbidities or history of recent surgical interventions in the body. We have mentioned about oral ulceration. We are aware of the causes, stress, very common cause, some local factor, some sort of trauma by some means, trauma from occlusion as well. So again, we have to look into more towards how we can solve locally, how the self-help and our advice can help. And a lot of medications are available as per your choice. Try to give those medications at right time, assure and reassure. And in cases of some sort of herpetic infections, you can not only add on the required antivirals, you can also take a referral or sort of a second consult from your super specialty. So what I'm trying to convey is we have to attend every situation as per the gravity. And if this is not working, then we need to look into the urgent care and emergency care. We don't want, because of the specific pandemic, we are putting patients at risk. That is what is to be avoided completely. And that is what has been even notified by Dental Council of India and Indian Dental Association, that we have to look for the good of the patient, protecting ourselves, protecting our team. A very good possibility, people are having good amount of food at home. They may be taking good diet as well. Possibility of cracked tooth or a fractured tooth, or could be a loose tooth which is displaced, or a restoration which has been broken. Now, these are the issues where, you know, patient will complain of pain, sensitivity, find it difficult to clean because of a constantly open cavity. There could be a broken tooth impinging on the tongue. or a mobile tooth which is not allowing patient to bite or close properly. Here it's reverse. It becomes an emergency care because these are the concerns which may not need any major intervention, but to protect further deterioration, you might have to call these patients and you might have to do a temporary restoration or maybe remove the small fragment of the tooth which is broken. Or if it's a cracked tooth syndrome, you might have to treat it as well. So these are the things which we need to carry from here. What stage is needed for what type of ailment and what is the best possible remedy to maintain the confidence of the patient and to continue with the practice. Even we have a lot of patients in our country who are wearing the dentures, and these people are old age people. We have to be very, very careful. Look for their problem. Understand with their accompanying family members what they are feeling, what is their main issue, and then try to cover up the issue by providing them analgesia if needed, and tell them that you can use the dentures for only when you are chewing food. Rest of the time you can remove it, and if possible, maintain them by giving them an advice of taking care of the denture, or visit the dental clinic in case some repair or some fine tuning is needed with the denture. In that situation, you are not giving any major treatment to them. Yes, this is very common. A lot of young crowd is with orthodontic treatment. They are at home playing a lot or maybe doing masti. So they can have either pain or some sort of soft tissue injury because of the braces or the wire. Such patients are also vulnerable because they might take the broken braces in by unknowingly. So once you are getting their call, attend them properly, guide them what they should take care, and you might have to call if they're too small to handle themselves. Then you might have to call and remove the braces or brackets which are not in a good situation. So in almost every scenario, some or the other problem is existing. Dental alveolar injuries, history of fall, playing at home or moving on the track or running on the ground. Anything can happen. So again, you have to look into, because it's a fresh injury, you might have to look for emergency care first. And then you can maintain these patients by advice and self-help. You may not call them again. Just primary relieve the concern, primary provide the best treatment for the situation. And then you can have a follow-up as an advice and self-help. So every stage, you are not only giving them the best, you are also maintaining a good rapport with them so that they should not lose their confidence and get stressed out for any issue. Even the possibility of getting avulsed, displaced or fractured teeth is always there. How to maintain them? These will be these similar things. If the permanent tooth has been knocked out, you have to advise the patient to handle the tooth by its crown, avoid touching the root. All those descriptive methods what we are routinely following will come in a picture of your on phone consultation, and then these all will be followed by urgent care because nobody want to lose the permanent tooth, and we should assure them again these procedures may or may not need too much of manipulation and generation of the aerosol, but whatever is to be taken care of, we need to give them on priority. Once we have given the primary treatment, then always we can follow that as a self-help or on phone advice to take care of the further steps of the treatment. So this is what I wanted to share with you about maintaining a routine dental practice, taking care of the patient, taking care of yourself, taking care of your staff is not only our moral responsibility, it is our legal responsibility as well. Dental Council of India has given excellent framework for everyone, every dentist to understand what they are supposed to do and what they are not supposed to do. Friends, this is the governing body. They are following, they are giving us the regulations. Don't breach with them. Don't try to play with them. You have to take care of your infrastructure by maintaining it as per the given protocol. You have to take care of your staff by maintaining and protecting them as recommended. At last, you have to maintain yourself. You have to take care of your own working style. You have to cover yourself completely. If you are wearing one layer more, it's not going to matter. But if you're breaching, it may trouble you for long. Cross infections are existing in COVID-19 pandemic with best of the safety guards as well. So you have to take 100% coverage of yourself. We are here to support the society. We are here to serve our patients, but not at the risk of our own health and life. If we are healthy, if we are good in shape, we can work long. Don't jump into conclusions very fast. I have been at home for 30 days. This is the time I have to look into practice. Please wait. Please make sure that you have all arrangements for yourself. You have all arrangements for your patients. You have all arrangements for your staff. Then only systematically plan. Reduce your per day appointments. Look into only some number of people coming to you if at all you want to practice immediately. But make sure you attend the patient. You don't deny them. If you don't want to attend, refer to the center where they are taking the patients. Patients should not suffer continuously with the problem. That is the simple message what Dental Council of India has always been making as an appeal. This advisory, which has been released on 16th April, is very, very good. Please go through it and you will realize that a lot of important points you will find to understand what they want to say. Some considerations which I have already taken care of in this presentation. Three liquids which you must have for cleaning. One is hydrogen peroxide. Then 0.2 povidone. This is for mouth rinsing of every patient who is walking into a place. Three liquids which you want to maintain for your floor. Hot water, 1% sodium hypochlorite and 70% alcohol. These are the 3-4 things which you need in your practice to take care of your safety issues and sanitizing issues as well. Follow whatever has been mentioned on the dental treatment consideration section of the DCI circular. Dispose of everything as been recommended by all the pollution control boards. Do not try to do a mix-up of everything and send it across. If it is noticed it is from your clinic, you will be heavily penalized in this COVID pandemic time, because they have revised a lot of penalties. They are not, the corporation or the local bodies are not knowing, listening to it. And there's an appeal of President, Dental Council of India, wherever any opportunity arises, dental professionals, faculties, dental students should volunteer to contribute and serve during this national calling and march in unison with the government to curb the menace of COVID-19. That's what I was stressing since beginning. Please don't deny the treatment to the patient. Be good enough to attend. And then if you find you can work on the patient, do it with full protection, full care. And that is the appeal, which is from the Dental Council of India. And I'm sure I have been given the guideline, whatever was to be presented. I have covered almost everything. And if there are questions, then we'll be taking care of these questions right now. Thank you so very much for your patient time. And if you have any query, you can send me as an SMS, WhatsApp, or you can mail me. I'm available for helping all my professional colleagues. And I am sure that this is not only a time to understand the gravity of situation, but it's also giving us a good learning that what is the importance of protection of your patient, protection of your staff, protection of yourself when we are doing the dental procedures. And until we follow it as a regular protocol, these things are difficult to, you know, adopt in our routine practice. I'm sure post lockdown, when we are going to start our practice, these all things will be of high importance. And at last, when you are beginning your practice after the lockdown, follow few things very, very properly. When you are going to the clinic for the first day, keep your cleaning open for 2-3 hours before even you start cleaning the areas. Once the air exchange happens, then everything should be cleaned using a wet mop method. And then follow the cleaning process of 3-bucket system. Finally, sodium hypochlorite to use on the floor. 70% alcohol to clean all the metal surfaces, all the smooth surfaces. Then wait, try to look into the atmosphere of your clinic. Go slow, look into 1 or 2 consults a day, and then slowly and gradually, once you are confident, then you do it. PPEs, some are for single use, some are for multiple use. Select properly. N95 mask, one per person. They can be reused by hot air oven method. Follow it judiciously to save the cost of your patients and of your operational issues. And make sure you do your best as dental professional at this point of time. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Himanshu, for the lovely session. In the next 1 minute, we would be starting with the live question and answer session.
Sure. Thanks a lot, Ruben.
Friends, I would like to request you to kindly note down your questions. Dr. Himanshu would be answering them one by one. Thank you. Since we are having an array of questions, I would like to start with the live question and answer session. Starting with the first question, we have a question from Mirza Afzal Beg. Adding Betadine in booster bottle, can it be helpful?
You can add any disinfectant solution in a booster bottle, but make sure that whatever solution you are using in that bottle, at the end of the day, you have to throw it. It should not go for next day. And Betadine, you have to follow then ratio of the Betadine. Should not, if you're just putting few mLs in a half a liter bottle, it may not work good. So make sure that you are putting any liquid, one, which is in proper ratio. Secondly, it's not disturbing your tubings. If the scaling is happening within inside the tubing, which is going to carry the solution from the booster bottle, it may cause another problem for the system to function.
Thank you for answering to the question. We are moving on with the next question. Drugs which we can prescribe safely to the patients during this COVID-19. Can you please name some of them?
Analgesics are allowed without ibuprofen combinations. So you can use paracetamol on higher dose. You can use paracetamol 650, maybe 6 hourly each. You can also use plain diclofenac sodium. You can also use aciclofenac. But make sure that primary management of the pain should as per the situation. We know that sometimes our patients are very reactive. Doctor, after taking this tablet, nothing is happening. So whatever is the time of action, you have to explain the patient properly. Even Ketorol DT, which is a brand name, also works very good in certain situations. But make sure whatever is the medical history of the patient, that part should not get neglected when you're prescribing any analgesic. In terms of antibiotics, whatever antibiotics are recommended as per the type of infection, only those antibiotics should be given. it should not be a covering antibiotic. Like sometimes we just try to do a combination of an antibiotic and analgesic without understanding the requirement of it. That should not happen. We have to be very, very judicious in use of all these medicaments. If you find that local antibiotic paste, in certain situation is possible to be used, use them. That doesn't cause too much of harm to anyone. And keep it simple. That is the straight away answer. Instead of doing emotional request from the patient, be professional to address this, the condition of the patient.
Thank you for answering the question, Doctor. We're moving on with the next question. We have a question from Dr. Karthik Bhanushali from Mumbai, India. Is fumigation advisable with the use of fog machine?
In a setup where you have controls, when you're doing a fumigation using a fogging machine, all the areas have to be properly closed. It depends from clinic to clinic and from workplace to workplace. It's not contraindicated. But if you are using a fogging machine, there is a process which is to be followed. And then once you are done with the fogging for 2 to 3 hours, you cannot take any new patient inside. Now, most of the time in our clinical setups, we do not have closed chamber sort of situation. Fumigation is more into the areas where all the channels are blocked. The doors are sealed. The windows are sealed and the whole area is then fogged out. Such type of clinics will be very, very easy to fumigate. Otherwise, we have to avoid. We just have to look into the possible options of disinfection using sodium hypochlorite and mopping it with 70% alcohol.
Thank you. We are moving on with the next question. We have a question from Dr. Siju Thomas from Dubai. He says, thank you for the lovely information and for the fantastic presentation. I really appreciate your efforts in making us understand. Since my practice runs only with cosmetic dentistry, which includes dental implants and veneers, will I be affected with my patient flow?
Thanks, doctor, for asking a good question. I just want to say, even the patients are not willing to accept complicated patient treatments. So if you are in implant practice, we know that it's not like it's an urgent care or emergency situation. So keep assuring your patients that this is not the time for intervention in your jaw. And we know that we will be touching mouth, we will be touching saliva, we will be exposed to the respiratory tract of the patient. The risk is equal to the patient as well as to you. We may protect ourselves by using all those PPEs and everything, but patient is under a good amount of exertion, good amount of minimal approach of site preparation and trauma and everything. So my say is that we should avoid as much, and general care and general work is all which is possible to take. Use of aerators, use of drills, use of fast moving spirals. These are the things which we have to use it restrictively or with very high caution. Unless needed, avoid it.
Thank you. Moving on with the next question, we have a question from Dr. Piyush Dua, who's asking, how can we identify the patient with COVID-19 if asymptomatic, if he or she comes to the clinic?
Very good question. A very straightforward answer. No one can identify. It's only your rigid history taking.
Absolutely.
And the more you are able to, interact with the patient, understanding the whereabouts, we have to take it as universal carriers. Like if we see the surgical division of medical field, when the patients are walking in for surgery, they assume that every patient is suffering with HIV. They assume that every patient is suffering with HBsAg. So this is the scenario that we have to accept it. We are not knowing which patient is a carrier, which patient is a suspect, and which patient is going to be positive. So from our side, maximum history taking followed by best protection is the only way to address such situation.
Thank you. Moving on with the next question, we have a question from Sitarama Prasad Kasena. He's asking why ibuprofen should not be used in the present scenario.
Doctor, there are a lot of interactions which are happening when the ibuprofen is getting introduced into the bloodstream. And as I said, we are not aware which patient is carrier, which patient is suspect, which patient is going to be a positive patient. So if the ibuprofen is already existing in the body, the chances of the air exchange based reactions which are happening at the cellular level within the lungs, that gets impacted. That's the reason why worldwide the use of this particular medicine has been restricted heavily for safety of the mankind.
Thank you. We're moving on with the next question. We have a question from Sweden, from Dr. Catherine. She says, we really appreciate your efforts on this presentation and it was wonderfully presented. Since we have not been informed clearly about dentist guidelines in our country, that is Sweden, shall I use your guidelines as my checklist?
Thank you. Yeah, certainly. These are the universal guidelines. These are the guidelines which have been released by CDC. These are the guidelines which are released by WHO. These are the guidelines which are released by Government of India, Dental Council of India. Even the UK government has following the similar guidelines. So all these guidelines are the protective ways to look into our practice. So there's no harm if something is going in a structured way with a framework. One can always use it. If it is proving good at one part of the world, it will prove good at every part of the world. Most of the time, we find the area of convenience. That we have to avoid. If this is a protocol, if this is a framework, we should follow it as it is without disturbing it.
Thank you. We're moving on with the next question. We have a question from Dr. Prakriti Achar. She says, this was by far the best webinar I have attended as far as dentistry is concerned. So it's an appreciation. Thank you so much, Dr. Himanshu. The question is N95 mask the only saver mask? Are there any other economical options?
Thank you, Doctor. There are good options. Even you follow two surgical mask technique with a shield, that is also possible to use it. But it's not recommended. As I said, we have to follow what is recommended. In this era, recommendation is N95 mask. So we should not take an option to. If they give choice between mask and N95 mask, then it becomes a different issue. As of now, every government, every governing body is giving recommendations. So when these are the recommendations, we don't have choice. And as I said, N95 mask can be reused by hot air oven. So if you are using the cost-effective method of two surgical masks, they are costing you 30 rupees. You use it in three patients. It is equivalent to the cost of one N95 mask, or maybe five patient, one N95 mask. Whereas one N95 mask can be reused for 10 times, can be used for 15 times. There is a WHO recommended protocol. So as of now, let us not look into options of N95 mask. We should restrict to N95 or higher mask, but we have to be very, very clear that we receive a real N95 mask, not a fake mask.
Thank you. Moving on with the next question, we have a question from Dr. Raju Kuriakose from Kerala, who says, thank you for the lovely presentation. The above guidelines that you have given in the presentation are for dentists who hold big clinics. What about dentists with small clinics? We are going to lose patients and lose revenue in the same time. Is the Dental Council of India offering us some kind of compensation to save our clinics, like other countries offering interest-free loan and insurances to protect the dental practices and dental life?
Doctor, I just want to reassure you, in India, we are 130 crores. Just try to stay safe for some time. All your patients will come back to you. It's not going to happen that after COVID-19 pandemic, people are leaving dental treatments. It's not going to happen. Yes, I know a lot of countries, their medical professionals or their medical professional bodies are moving to the government for some sort of compensation or some sort of relief. As far as the loans are concerned, even that relief has been announced in our country as well for professionals, for non-professionals, for industrialists, for a lot many people. But rest assured that patients will come back. They don't move or migrate for dental treatment from here to there. Rather, there will be a chunk of patients which were never yours will also come to you. You have to be ready. Your preparedness have to be there. And I am not focusing my presentation towards large clinics or big clinics. It is for any and every dental clinic. Whatever protocols have been shared with you, they will work for my clinic, your clinic, any clinic in India, or maybe a multi-specialty big dental hospital as well. These are the guidelines. These are the recommendations which are not based on the size of the clinic. They are based on what is needed for dental professional. So it is more of a professional protection as a recommendation which is coming from the government. Rest assured, the moment we are coming out of this COVID-19 pandemic is going to be a complete new era of practicing dentistry. Believe me.
Thank you. We move on with the next question. We have a question from Dr. Amar Gandur from Saudi Arabia. He's saying, I want to know, I have clinics in Saudi and Egypt. Are these guidelines standard for all the countries or each country must follow regional guidelines?
See, when we talk about the guidelines, these guidelines are universal guidelines. Only difference is whether they have been recommended by your country or not, or by your board or not. So that becomes very country specific. These guidelines do not have anything which is going to harm a dental professional. These are all very high standards of safety and protocols. But if your country or your board in your country has not come up with these, either a group of people need to show or forward it to them and get it as an approval so that all the country professionals are able to follow it. Else, WHO is a body or CDC is a body which is worldwide accepted. So if anybody is questioning you, you can always mention from where you have got these guidelines.
Thank you. Moving on with the next question, we have a question from Dr. Sezian, who's asking, how much will be the time interval duration for giving appointments to patients in between each patient? That's one question. The second question is, how is the surgical handpiece sterilized during this pandemic? Are there any additional recommended disinfectants to be added?
One, the scheduling of the patient. We know that if we are working in a single chair operatory, as the recommendation is to clean after in between two patients. So effective cleaning, if we look into the cleaning of the dental chair unit, the cleaning of the equipment, the cleaning of our infrastructure, then probably it takes 15 to 20 minutes to clean one dental chair properly with the rubbing all across all the points of the chair. Then you are also looking into the surroundings, which are also to be mopped again. If I share my time difference between two patients, it is, as of now, I'm keeping one patient per hour. So there is a gap of 1 hour in between two patients. I'm restricting purely for those patients who are coming for either urgent care or emergency care. 90% of my patients are handled on a phone call or the way we discuss on WhatsApp or some other channel. So, yes, we have to maintain a good amount of time which is needed for sterilization and disinfection of our area. As far as handpiece is concerned, if you follow a routine protocol of handpiece disinfection, including autoclave, right? So, right from cleaning it with the alcohol-based solution, then putting it in the oil solution or lubricating it with the oil solution and then autoclaving it. So this cycle also takes about 45 minutes. So if you have limited handpieces or infrastructure, then probably a time gap of 1 hour will make sure of every change which is needed or recommended from various authorities.
Thank you. Moving on with the next question, we have a question from Dr. Kasima. Was asking, can we use regular latex gloves or only nitrile gloves?
Here, the challenge is for routine latex gloves, we are not knowing what is the penetration level. And if at this point of time, if you look my personal recommendation, I am going into the disposable gloves only. So we should not risk ourselves. And anyhow, if you look into the protocol of PPE, you'll realize there is a two-layer technique of the gloves. So anyhow, you have to wear two set of gloves. So nitrile or the latex gloves overlapping each other or a disposable gloves at the top will help you to protect yourself.
Thank you. Moving on to the next question, we have a question from Dr. Akib, who's asking, so can we go for extraction in a COVID patient?
Is it COVID patient? That means it's a positive patient you're talking about.
I believe yes, because there is nothing specified.
Fine. So let us take a scenario of a COVID positive patient. A COVID positive patient directly will not come to you because the patient will be under treatment of the facility or the consultant who is treating for COVID positive. So if it has been recommended, then they will also recommend a lot of things to you. One, in terms of medication. Second, in terms of safety precautions. Third, in terms of your infrastructure. Fourth, in terms of use of disposable. So if you are able to follow all what has been recommended to take care of these patients, extraction per se is not contraindicated. Rather, any dental procedure per se is not contraindicated. It is more of a safety precaution, protection, and how you are going to perform, how you are going to limit the procedure time, how you are going to limit the generation of aerosols. These are the broad considerations. And certainly, you have to be mentally prepared that you are going to get the highest risk of the patient and infection at this point of time. So it's your own decision also whether you want to accept it for extraction or not.
Thank you. We are moving on with the next question. We have a question from Dr. Sangeeta D'Souza from Bangalore. She says, thank you for the excellent live webinar. My question is, since after COVID, patients will look more on hygiene of the clinic and doctor, how do you think I should prepare my in-house dentist?
Thanks, Dr. Sangeeta. It's a very appropriate question. Yes, patients are now very well aware of everything. So much of digital awareness have been created across the globe that now patients are going to ask you lot many things in your clinic and you have to be ready for it. Most of the time, because of the cost containment, we as dental professionals are quite submissive in explaining ourselves that why we are charging on higher side. This is the time to relook into your practice as well. What you are following and what you can follow and what is recommended. Looking at all these aspects, all the patients who are walking in, rest assured that even you have worked on these patients earlier are going to question you. And when they are going to question you, you have to give every reply with confidence and visibility. When I say visibility, that means if they're asking for an alcohol rub, it has to be there. If they're asking for a napkin and a wash basin, it has to be there. So, yes, this is, and that's the patient right. We should be happy to accept it. So, yes, certainly the patients are going to be a guiding force in redeveloping our dental practice as well.
Thank you. I hope Dr. Himanshu has answered your question, Dr. Sangeeta. We're moving on with the next question. We have an anonymous question. It says, is it advisable to do air rotor scaling procedures in COVID-19 patients?
In positive patients, if the situations are at threatening level, like there is some infection which is going to explode if it has not been treated, or some procedure which will allow the patient to be in relief or to reduce the distress, then under guidelines of the treating physician, these can be done with high level of protection. Both the procedures are going to generate aerosols. Both the procedures are on high scale of rotations. So your staff, yourself as a treating doctor and the patient all have to be very, very safe. Now, the very important thing is you are using the same machine to treat a COVID-19 patient and a COVID-19 non-patient. Now, this unit has to be disinfected properly. So if your dental chair is not with the auto sterilization method, which are generally in very high-end dental chairs, this is where the dental clinic will be in trouble. If your tubings are not getting cleaned and you are treating a patient, one COVID-19 and other COVID-non-19, then what you will do? So this is how you need to design or decide your practice framework, that if the patient is coming as a COVID-19 positive, then what I'm going to do with the, my setup? Am I going to clean it completely, sterile it completely, fumigate it completely? And then you have to test it whether every part of your unit is micro tested. So it's a big challenge. It's not impossible to do, but when you're doing it, you have to be at very, very high risk of all your stakes.
Thank you. I hope you've got a satisfactory answer. Do I have the permission to ask you more questions, Dr. Himanshu?
Sure. No problem.
Okay, we're moving on with the next question. We have a question from Dr. Kalsina, who's asking for how many times can the N95 mask be sterilized in the hot air oven?
How many times?
Yes.
So, as I said, when we are following the protocol of WHO, WHO is recommending N95 use for maximum 30 days. So, if you are doing this procedure of hot air oven once in a day, you start wearing your N95 mask at the beginning of the day and you are using it for 8 hours, and then you are discarding it then you're sending it for the process in hot air oven. If you are doing it continuously, you can maximum use it for 25 to 30 days.
Thank you. Moving on with the next question, we have an anonymous question. Can we do enameloplasty in clinic to avoid trauma due to fractured tooth?
Again, you will be using either a low rotation micromotor or you will be using a rotor to do this. Avoid as much as possible until it's causing trauma to the patient.
Thank you. Moving on with the next question, we have a question from Dr. Oves Diku. What should be the procedure if we are attending the a patient through telemedicine or any other online app?
Yes, this is also working now, and Government of India has allowed the telemedicine, teledentistry or anypathy based consultations now. Make sure you are following a registered portal, one. Second, a registered vendor, two. And third, you are also registered for that service as a provider with your digital signs. And once the consultation is starting, there is a first page of consult as a consent of the patient. So make sure you follow all the directives of telemedicine and then you can proceed with the consultations. And those consultations are recorded in the system itself, but you should have that access, that whenever that patient is coming back to you or looking for a second opinion or a second consult, you are able to share the data points, whatever have been captured during a consultation.
Thank you. Moving on with the next question. If we have a HEPA filter on clinic, can we do aerosol producing treatments along with N95 mask and PPEs?
If you have HEPA filter,
it's in a clinic. Can we do aerosol producing treatments along with the N95 mask and PPEs?
It is permissible. There is no doubt about it. But you have to follow the protective guidelines, whatever have been shared. Your N95 should be there on everybody's face who is the part of your team. One. Secondly, once you are done with the procedure, the next procedure, there will be a delay. Why? Because the HEPA filter has an air exchange rate. And once that is completed, then only you can take second patient. So you have to be careful. Even if you have HEPA filter of good quality, the air exchange rate takes time. And until you have a system of verification of the air exchange rate, you may not be able to take a new patient same day. So if you are having this facility, you can do the procedures with added protection, but you have to have monitoring of HEPA filter as well.
Thank you. Moving on with the next question. What brand of handpiece would you recommend during the COVID-19 pandemic?
There is no change in brands of the equipments or instruments. Yes, if you are looking for discarding, then certainly there are so many handpieces which are coming in, at least in this part of the world, between 2,500 rupees to 4,000 rupees. If you are doing some treatment which is able to compensate and throw this handpiece as a disposable, then a lot many brands are available which you can use them and just throw them.
Thank you. Moving on with the next question, we have a question from Dr. Manisha. Is it required to start with hydroquinonol anti-malarial drugs like prophylaxis after dental consultation?
Make sure whatever medication you are taking as HCQ, it is to be prescribed by a physician. If you have any doubt that you have attended a suspect or a carrier or a COVID positive patient and you still are looking for a proper coverage of the medication, visit your physician friend, share your details. The physician will ask for a few questions, and then if he finds that yes, it is to be given, then take a prescription and buy the medicine. Do not try to opt yourself. Yes, if you are working in a hospital where the COVID patients are regularly allowed to visit and take treatment for COVID-19, then as a policy of the hospital, lot many hospitals are giving this coverage as a prophylactic dose to their staff. So my answer is very clear that until you get a clearance from your physician, you should not take HCQ.
Thank you. Moving on with the next question. This is from Dr. Nikhil Keswani, who's saying, can I practice orthodontic aligners as this system has nothing to do with in contact with blood?
Doctor, you can practice whatever you want to practice. There is no restriction. All emphasis is on protection, protection, and protection. So you yourself, your staff, and your infrastructure has to be well productive, protective, and you have to follow all the guidelines of maintaining the infrastructure, sterility, and disinfection.
Thank you. Moving on with the next question. COVID-19 status of a patient is unknown. Can we do air auto procedures in such patients? This is an anonymous question.
Aerator, as of now, we know that we have to reduce using it because we are not aware of the history of the patient. But if it is mandatory, then high wax suctions, cleaning of your aerators in between every patient, using of shields. I mean, the same answer that you have to follow all layers of protection and disinfection for performing the procedure if you are using an aerator.
Thank you. Moving on with the next question. This is a question from Dr. Siva Kalyan, who's asking for surface disinfection of all plain surfaces like slabs, cupboards, and all after any case, what can we use on chairs? On chairs, we use barrier films, but what about these surfaces?
So, I would mention once again, even the barrier films need to be protected. You cannot use it for months and days. You have to remove the barrier film at the end of the day and discard it. And in between the procedures, you have to use either sodium hypochlorite 1% or alcohol-based solution for cleaning all the smooth surfaces, metal surfaces, whatever you are coming in contact.
Thank you. We have a question from Dr. John. Will dental insurance cover the pandemic? Will dental and medical health insurance will have more attention in India year after the COVID-19 pandemic?
As far as the medical insurance is concerned, they are already been instructed and they have been regulated to provide all the coverage for the health scenarios coming out of COVID-19 pandemic. So for general COVID condition, there is no problem at all. Dental insurance per se, we do not have it in our country. If it comes and it is there, then COVID-19 will just become a situation as a as another condition. Like we are asking the history of HIV and HBsAg, same way the history of COVID-19 will go. The cost of consumables, the cost of materials will increase. And if dentistry gets this chance of dental insurance, these all will be accepted. As of now, we don't have any strengthened dental insurance system in our country, except for a few self-motivated companies promoting insurance.
Thank you. I believe the next one should be the last question. We have a question from Mr. Nitin Swami, who says, "Dear Dr. Buddha, I am a healthcare business. Since we know Indians and Indian government showed less interest on hygiene and public healthcare infrastructure, what do you think? What are your views during and after the COVID era? Will Indian citizen and government be able to learn about healthcare? And what will be a next healthcare industry revolution in India?"
Very good question, doctor. And if you see the last 7 days of Government of India, and if you see the type of investment being promoted all across India, all investment is in healthcare. The Prime Minister, the Health Minister, the Finance Minister, the State Ministers of various states, all have been instructed to speed up and raise the bar of healthcare in, setups. Everywhere in country, now they are giving maximum budget to prepare for the healthcare infrastructure. So this is a very, very positive sign, point one. Point two, the awareness, who wants to die? If a person can live long by just following few protocols, which in last 50 days are becoming the routine of our life, probably I feel this is a training given keeping you in jail. So we know that we are in lockdown and we are not having many choices. So once this becomes the protocol or a sort of awareness which is there right from a small kid to a 70-year-old or 80-year-old person, this will become a routine for everyone in coming days. Yes, the population base is very different. The population mix is very different. How many will follow, how many will not follow will be their own choice. But at large, these are the scenarios which will be changed drastically. And healthcare perspective in India is going to take a new good turn. And that turn is going to be favorable for every practice, no matter it is dentistry or medical practice. Being in the capacity of administrator of a hospital, I can very well say that almost every specialty is going to take a new dimension in developing themselves, in presenting themselves in front of the patients, and also in safeguarding the interest of the team. Initially, when we were practicing before this 60 days period, we were not too much interested in taking care of our fellow beings who are there as the co-workers. Yes, they were wearing masks, they were wearing gloves, they were having one apron, and that apron was getting washed after 5 days, 7 days, 10 days. So that part of concern, because now everybody is concerned, whether it is a teammate, whether it is family member, whether it is a population person, all are going to have a very changed behavior towards acceptance of new regimes which are coming up in healthcare. So I'm very much focused, and I am sure, I'm assuring you that in coming days, healthcare will have a different dimension in India as well.
Thank you. Last question before we wind up with the live webinar session. Is PPE needed for doing air rotor procedures in each and every patient?
Answer is yes. PPE is your personal protection equipment. whether you do OPD, that is just a consultation, or you do a procedure. Today, it is the recommended protective gear. So it is not related with whether you're doing a small procedure or a aerator procedure or a consult. PPE is now recommended as a barrier to be used between a patient and a doctor. So don't have a second thought that whether the PPE is needed or not. Yes, PPE is 100% needed, and needed from minor procedure, basic consultation, till any and every procedure.
Thank you. Dear attendees, with this, we come to an end of this beautiful yet interesting live webinar session. I would like to bring to your notice that the certificate of participation would be issued to you within 3 working days. On behalf of Team DentistChannel.online, I would like to congratulate Dr. Himanshu Gupta on the successful completion of this webinar. May you all have a good day. Thank you, Dr. Himanshu Gupta.
Thank you, Ruben. Thanks a lot. Thanks. My wishes to Dentist Channel Online for furthermore such presentations on this channel. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Doctor.